All right, it's now 16 minutes away from 8. Malcolm's with us on the program. Hello, mate. How are you?
I'm very well.
Excellent.
I'm very, very well, Marcus. And by the way, I understand this is the first time I'll be speaking to you while you're in the Grant Goldman studio.
Oh,
so well done.
Wonderful, yeah. Brand new studio. We're loving it. Everything seems to be working A-OK. Where are you at the moment? Still up north?
Back up north again, yeah, up in Townsville.
Okay.
And we went through Early Beach yesterday. But Grant, I enjoyed meeting Grant and working with him. He was a fabulous man. He really looked after the people because he connected with what was really going on. He had the guts to tackle big issues. And he was just a wonderful character. I know you've got a caller called John McRae who told me about the way Grant supported Lawrence Hoynes and others at his own cost. And it was just amazing, the courage of the man.
Yep, wonderful. And I know you had that relationship before, and we're very grateful that we continue to talk to you on this network and certainly on this program, mate. So thank you very much. Now, let's talk about changes to the university system. You support the government's changes. Why?
Well, they're reducing the fees for courses that that will meet the needs for the future of our country and jobs, practical courses that will, like engineering, like nursing, like teaching. And they'll be making courses like humanities, which have little direct relevance sometimes, immediate relevance. Mm-hmm. And that's what they're doing there to make universities more affordable and also to more practical. And what they're doing is also making sure that taxpayer funds are based on the skills that the country needs. So that's why we're supporting general. But we also see this as an opportunity to go further to ensure responsibility among students and reduce the taxpayer load and also to restore accountability in universities and to restore academic freedom because, as you know, that's been smashed.
Well, let's look at some of the figures here. I mean, we do need to address the growing $60 billion outstanding HEX debt. Australian debit is now pushing $1 trillion and money could be used productively if repaid. I mean, we need to limit student entitlement to 7 years full-time equivalent. Certainly, it takes on average around 10 years for a student to repay a HEX debt. And, you know, if you're getting people, students into some of these humanity courses, and I'm not knocking them, I did one. I did a Bachelor of Arts, obviously. I majored in journalism. But, you know, we need to ensure that whatever our kids are studying at uni will get them into gainful employment once they finish because we need these debts repaid.
That's right, and we're very concerned. Pauline in particular has been raising this issue for a number of years now, that the HEX debt is going up and up and up, and it's currently around $60 billion and growing, as you correctly pointed out. I love the way you use data. Pauline has been advocating that we reinstate the 10% discount if fees are paid up front. Now, that's because people who can afford university should not be getting a concessional interest rate. They should pay it up front. So let them do that, and that'll give the government better use of our funds. And also we want to reduce the threshold for income above which people start paying off the HEX debt. It's currently at $46,000 per annum income before you have to start repaying. We want to reduce that so that people start paying it back earlier because all we're seeing is the HEX debt rising incredibly and people basically on fee-free university education. We also want to raise the standards by which they're allowed to continue so that if they're failing, then they don't continue.
Well, that's right.
So what?
Yeah, I mean, it's important, I think, to have our institutions, our tertiary institutions, monitor students' academic progress. And if they are repeatedly failing, well, then they should stop getting fee help, particularly if they don't pass half the subjects.
That's right. And we need to make students aware that they're getting something from taxpayers and they're getting money that supports their courses. So we need to make students more accountable for that. It's not just continue to get to live off the taxpayer. We've got to get job-ready graduates, and so we applaud the government for this initiative, but we want to take it further to bring back that accountability in the universities and also on the students.
All right, I want to go to this issue here of the fact that you do a lot of travelling there in Queensland, which is wonderful, Malcolm, because, you know, that's how you get on top of grassroots issues. You speak to the punters out there and, you know, constituents. Again, you're still hearing that businesses can't find anyone willing to work. Fruit pickers in southern Queensland, in tourism and hospitality, charter boat operators in the Whitsundays are cancelling cruises, the retail sector's struggling at Airlie Beach. I mean, why can't we fill these positions? Is it, again, down to the fact that JobKeeper, and JobSeeker to an extent is, you know, so generous at the moment?
Well, it's really not JobKeeper, Marcus. It's JobSeeker that's the problem.
Right. Okay.
JobKeeper has actually kept some businesses going, kept them afloat. So we've got to be careful about that. There are some businesses that haven't been able to get JobKeeper, and they should be able to. But anyway, that's another issue. But JobSeeker is what's keeping some people on the couch instead of getting off their backside and going doing some work. So fruit pickers in southern Queensland, I think we talked about that a couple of weeks ago as well. Strawberry pickers, raspberry pickers, they just can't get people, and they can't get locals, can't get Aussies. And what we've relied upon is backpackers to do that job.
Yeah.
And just a couple of days ago, we were in Airlie Beach in Whitsunday. Yeah, I know. Someone's got to do it, mate.
Oh,
but
look,
anyway,
terrible, Malcolm. Yes.
But anyway, the tourism and hospitality sector are finding it difficult to get even boat crews. So they've had to cancel charter boat operators in the Whitsundays, cancel cruises because they can't get people to do jobs because it's too easy, too attractive on JobSeeker. And then retail, we see shopkeepers who are desperate for staff. But we've also seen, you know, at a time when we've got a massive growing debt and lowering productivity, we've also got shopkeepers paying inordinate amounts for electricity, especially government charges.
Sure.
And they're saying themselves, all they're doing is picking up a huge risk and picking up huge stress. They have to work longer hours because they can't afford it. So we've got a complete need to look at how we treat people and how we treat businesses, taxation, regulations. We're destroying our country, Marcus.
All right. Well, the Prime Minister today is, you know, about to spruik a modern manufacturing strategy. There's a little bit of renewable energy thrown in the mix. I mean, I don't know. We've got a Conservative Premier in New South Wales who's gone on the record as saying, we're not real good at building things, but the Prime Minister says we are. I mean, I like the idea of it, kickstarting manufacturing and, you know, building manufacturing jobs and really investing in the sector in New South Wales and around Australia. But is this more marketing? Are these going to be more slogans today? Can the government really back this up? Are you sceptical?
I am completely sceptical, and you've hit the nail on the head. It's just more marketing from Scott Morrison. Look, the basics of manufacturing are electricity charges, and we're pushing the UN agenda and driving our electricity through the roof. And what we're doing is exporting those jobs to China, India, Asia, because they're generating electricity at 8 cents a kilowatt hour using our coal that's been carted overseas for thousands of kilometres. We're selling electricity in this country at 25 cents a kilowatt hour, and that's ridiculous because we're using the same coal. And the only difference is the regulations that the government has put on place due to the UN. And the second thing is we're over-regulated. We've got so many regulations in this country that small business just cannot compete. Large business cannot compete. Our taxation structure gives incentives to foreign multinationals rather than local companies. And then we've had the Lima Declaration that both parties signed. Whitlam Labor Party signed it in 1975, and Fraser's Liberal Party ratified it the following year. And that has exported our jobs, our manufacturing. So until we start restoring our political sovereignty and national sovereignty, we are not going to restore our economic sovereignty. It's that simple. And Scott Morrison on October 3rd, I think last year, was talking about the unelected international bureaucrats and unaccountable international bureaucrats. And then since then, he's advocated giving the UN's World Health Organization, a corrupt organization, increased power. So the man says one thing and does another. We will not get anywhere until we stop the UN.
All right, well said. As always, great to have you on the program, Malcolm. Let's chat again next week. Appreciate it. You take it easy up there at Airlie Beach, Townsville. You're not taking a little charter boat over to Maggie today to really rub it into me, are you? Hey?
No. We'll be heading down into the Gadalee Basin and the Bowen Basin coalfields to listen. Right. We're pushing some things on safety there.
Well, let's hear a little more about that next week when we get you back on. Thanks, Malcolm. Take care.
Thanks, Marcus.
One Nation Senator Malcolm Roberts.